I was an angry mess. Then I found God. I was gay. Then I found Jesus. I was on drugs. Then I joined the church. I was lost. Then I was found. We've all heard it before, and it's hard to discuss because it gets so personal, so emotional. It came up in a video I discussed before, Got Questions Ministries Bit on the Inerrancy of the Bible.
A third internal evidence is the Bible's unique authority and power. While this evidence is more subjective than the first two, it is no less a powerful testimony of the divine origin of the Bible. The Bible's authority is unlike any other book ever written. This authority and power are best seen in the way countless lives have been transformed by the supernatural power of God's Word. Drug addicts have been cured by it, homosexuals set free by it, derelicts and deadbeats transformed by it, hardened criminals reformed by it, sinners rebuked by it, and hate turned to love by it.
Do success stories give credibility to religious claims? And to religion in general? First of all, I want to sidestep a common conservative tactic, selective statistical analysis. They like to point out they're happier than liberals in the US on average, but it's not that simple. Being conservative is linked to certain personality traits, after all. Is the conservatism what makes them happy? Is it the personality trait? Is it something else? One study concluded that the happiest people are conservatives who live in a liberal country. What of that? In Latin America, religion is correlated with lower rates of suicide, whereas in East Asia, the opposite is true. What's the conclusion? It's difficult to be certain because one can only make arguments from correlation. I want to focus instead on the logic of the core claim, what it's asserting and what it's ignoring. Do success stories give credibility to religion? 1. Religion can help people. Religion absolutely can help people. Whether it's the most efficient or the only way to do so is another question worth considering, but for now, let us concede the truth. Religion has helped many people over the ages. For all that I complain about my religious experience, there was good as well. Good friendships, a context in which to volunteer my talents, being told to be selfless and to help people, etc. 2. Religion can hurt people. If religion's ability to help people could prove its truth, what does the opposite do? Do the pedophilia scandals of the Catholic Church and Jehovah's Witnesses prove those religions to be false? When religion helps people, the faithful proclaim this as evidence of God's truth. When the pedo priests pop up, they cry out, "Not all priests." And of course, not all. I mean, who would use this tragedy to enforce a narrative without solid logical reasoning? But that's not the problem. These institutions enabled these holy men to thrive undisturbed and actively covered up their crimes. And the scandals seem to be doing nothing to change the beliefs of the faithful, which... Why can I point to so many examples of my church doing tangible harm to people close to me, but I have to sit and ponder what good things it gave me that weren't already just an extension of my personality and the teaching of my parents? Why hasn't the love of God reformed these institutions? But you get my point. If churches get to take responsibility for the good they do, they have to accept responsibility for the ill that seems to be just as inherent to their existence. 3. Practicality is not a measure of factuality. The idea we're discussing is the positive outcomes of a philosophy demonstrating its truth. If you talk to a former cult member, some of them will say they wish they had the certainty and the security they once had. But I can guarantee that almost all of them would say they'd rather have the uncertain and strange truth over the lie of the cult. I wasn't part of a cult, probably, but I echo their sentiment. I would rather die for the truth than live for a lie. My favorite movie is the 1966 film A Man for All Seasons, which chronicles the final years of the life of Sir Thomas More.
Arrest him.
For what?
He's dangerous.
For libel. He's a spy.
Father, that man's bad.
There's no law against that.
There is God's law.
Then God can arrest him.
While you talk, he's gone.
And go he should if he were the devil himself until he broke the law.
So, now you'd give the devil benefit of law.
Yes, what would you do? Cut a great road through the law to get after the devil?
Yes. I'd cut down every law in England to do that.
Oh? And when the last law was down and the devil turned round on you, where would you hide, Roper, the laws all being flat? This country is planted thick with laws from coast to coast, man's laws, not God's. And if you cut them down, and you're just the man to do it, do you really think you could stand upright in the winds that would blow then? Yes, I'd give the devil benefit of law for my own safety's sake.
I love this movie. It's philosophical, old, British, dry, beautiful, well-acted. But anyway, Sir Thomas refused to explicitly approve the annulment of Henry VIII's first marriage to Catherine of Aragon to make way for his marriage with Anne Boleyn. Sir Thomas, a staunch Catholic, would accept nothing less than a papal annulment, which the English monarch never received. Sir Thomas was condemned to death despite his articulate defense of his right to his own beliefs. And Sir Thomas More, or at least the way he's depicted in the film, is one of my heroes. Nothing could compel him to sacrifice his intellectual integrity. I find that incredibly admirable. Damn, now I really want an opera about Sir Thomas More. But what I'm saying is you can believe something to be true and have it kill you or make you unhappy. The truth is a concept that has no personified embodiment required to take pity on you or your emotions. Practicality is not a measure of factuality. 4. There are different kinds of truth. This is probably one of the better things you'll hear Jordan Peterson say. I hope he's a harbinger of the path religion will take in the future, and not...
And a woman actually disagreed with me in the middle of my preaching. You know, I said something and she said I was wrong. You know, and I kind of, you know, blew up a little bit. But anyway...
Earth is a globe. True. Water is necessary for our survival. True. Murder is immoral. True. The story of Hamlet is... true? False? Well, that's a different question, isn't it? There are plenty of characters who are fictional that ring true. To the average person, Luke Skywalker feels more real than James K. Polk. And Luke has instructed more of us with his fictional courage than Polk has with his incredible presidential work ethic. This is a complicated subject that I can't do justice in a few minutes, so let's leave it there for the moment. Can religion, even if it holds no empirical truth, offer another, more metaphorical truth? I think if there's any validity to the original claim, this is it. One must ask, however, is this claim simply sophistry used to get religion off the hook for its more unsightly deeds? It probably isn't intended that way, but I want to confirm that religion holding metaphorical truth does not preclude that same metaphorical truth coming from non-religious sources. Religion holding metaphorical truth does not prove any of its historical or spiritual claims. Religion holding metaphorical truth does not provide an excuse to avoid religious reform, something I would argue is necessary for every religion of which I know. And so let me ask the question again. Do success stories prove religious claims? Most definitely not. The most they could prove is that holding certain beliefs have certain psychological or practical effects, at least some of the time. Maybe that's all religion ever needed to be, a practical way for us to unleash our imaginations, tame our qualms about the meaning of life and death, and provide an easy-to-understand context in which to offer help to the weak. We're not there yet, but someday, who knows, maybe religion will evolve into something better.